Greetings and welcome to SCMC Perspectives, organized by Symbiosis Center for Media and Communication, Pune. I am Kanisha Shah from Batch 2022, here to welcome you all to today's session. SCMC Perspectives is a dialogic forum where students get acquainted with diverse themes in the media industry. We're conversing with globally lauded professionals from academia and practitioners alike. Regardless of the pandemic, we through SCMC Perspectives believe in striding forward and offering finest exposure to the students. In the past sessions, we have had speakers like Mr. Kang Mingo, South Korean filmmaker, researcher and collaborator Mr. Raju Roy Chaudhary from University of São Paulo, Brazil, and many of the speakers from countries like Thailand, Australia, and various parts of the United States of America. Our guest speaker for the day is Ms. Rina Guerra, an acclaimed filmmaker, director, and screenwriter, who will be talking to us about her journey of making and releasing independent films. Today's session of SCMC Perspectives is made extra special owing to the presence of Dr. Vidya Yerovdekar, Pro-Chancellor of Symbiosis International University and Principal Director of Symbiosis Society. Thank you, Rohina Ma'am, for accepting our invitation, and thank you, Vidya Ma'am, for gracing us with your presence. Dr. Vidya is an MD, holds a degree in law, and PhD in internationalization of higher education in India. An AVE researcher, she has numerous research publications to her credit and has also authored several books. Her foresight and leadership have been instrumental in creating strategic collaborations with universities across the globe. She has been ranked 14 among India's top 25 powerful women by Fame India magazine. As a member of University Grants Commission for two terms, Central Advisory Board of Education under Ministry of Education, and Indian Council for Cultural Relations under Ministry of External Affairs, she has been a facilitator of innovative approaches to higher education in India. She is also a chairperson of FICCI Committee on Higher Education and is serving her third term. Dr. Vidya has been appointed as member of India Brand Equity Foundation Trust, set up by the Ministry of Commerce and Industries, Government of India, to promote the brand India overseas in the overseas market. Ma'am has also been appointed as the first chair of the OBREL Global India Chapter for the period of 3 years. Ma'am is also a member of boards of several education, industrial, and governmental organizations. Dr. Vidya's hard work has won her numerous awards and accolades, and she is now focused on making Symbiosis International University a benchmark among the best universities in Asia. I would now like to pass the baton to Dr. Sriram Gopalakrishnan, Director of Symbiosis Center for Media and Communication, Pune, to welcome our guests.
Good afternoon. Respected Dr. Vidya Ma'am, Pro-Chancellor, Symbiosis International University, and Principal Director, Symbiosis Society, esteemed guest and acclaimed film director, Ms. Rohina Guerra, distinguished invitees, students, staff, and faculty at SCMC. It is indeed a privilege to welcome all of you for this edition of the SCMC Perspective. It is a matter of great honor and pride to have Dr. Vidya Ma'am on this occasion. She is our inspiration and our symbol. Every day, our endeavor at SCMC is to fulfill her vision of taking Symbiosis to greater heights at the global level. On behalf of SCMC, it is my pleasure to welcome her for this occasion. Ms. Rohina Guerra's film, Sir, is the talk of the film industry. It has been widely appreciated by the audience and the discerning critics as well. For the younger generation, Ms. Rohina Guerra's film has been a clarion call to visualize a world where barriers can be broken, to visualize a new way to make films. And on behalf of SCMC, it is my pleasure to welcome her to SCMC Perspectives. Without taking any more time, I ask Anisha to take the proceedings further.
Thank you so much, sir. Vidya Ma'am, we would also like to hear a few words from your side.
Thank you so much, Riram, for inviting me for this wonderful event. And it's my pleasure to be here when Rohina is the chief guest. I've seen her as a little kid. And I'm so very proud of you, Rohina. I've watched the film. I've seen the film. Now, you know, when you're sitting at home, and especially during lockdowns, you do get time to even watch films, which otherwise, you know, it was very difficult. But I must say that, you know, your creation is excellent, wonderful. And as Sriram very rightly said, it has different perspectives, and I'm sure you want to talk about it. Sriram, I'm here because, you know, Rohina's family, her mother, Nalini Gera, is the daughter of Mr. Okay. Atur Santani, late Sri Atur Santani, who has helped my father, Dr. Muzumdar, in days when he really needed help. When Symbiosis today is at a position, there are several people who will come forward to help him or me. But at a point in time when Symbiosis was just an idea, which a professor of botany thought, and you know, people in Pune city at least didn't accept that idea, but there was just one man called Mr. Atur Santani who with open arms welcomed Dr. Muzumdar to his house every time he went, and you know, helped him both financially and with other resources. In fact, the first campus that was built on Senapati Bapat Road, the 2 acres campus, which was just the Symbiosis International Cultural Center, was built by Mr. Atur Santani without charging any money. And whenever Dr. Muzumdar got the money through fees, he paid the loan back. So it's an association of, you know, several decades. And I must say that after Mr. Atur Santani, of course, Nalini, who's a very close friend of mine, and Kumar Gera, both of them, we've fortunately have maintained this, you know, this very close relation. And whether it's Rohina or her brothers, Rohit and Nikhil, all three of them are doing exceedingly well. And I'm more happy with Rohina because, you know, the creative skills that you've got from your mother, who was also a journalist and an excellent writer, I think it comes from there. And I'm very, very glad, Rohina, that you're here with us. I should also tell you that we've recently instituted a chair in our Faculty of Engineering, you know, under the name of Sri Atur Santani Chair of Engineering. And we are now about to select a professor for this chair. So there will be a chair professor with his name. And that will be something that, you know, as a legacy that, you know, your family has left with Symbiosis. Other than, of course, one of the buildings of Symbiosis, which is named as Atur Center in Model Colony, which you know of. So this is a very, very long association. And I'm very happy that, you know, now the third generation to be associated with Symbiosis. So Sriram, it should not be just one-off event where Rohina comes and speaks about her film
or sure, ma'am.
That she's created, but get her involved more. You know, she will be an excellent teacher. I know she cannot spend full time with us, but certainly as an adjunct or in whatever capacity, Rohina, you can. Because, you know, you need to share your practical knowledge with our young students here. Now, we also have a media institute here at Lovely, where I'm sitting right now at the university campus, which is a postgraduate media school. I mean, you can be associated with that school as well. So that, you know, we continue this legacy of association with the Santani family through you. So with these few words, I once again welcome you, Rohina, to this wonderful, you know, event. And I'm looking forward to listening, you know, to your thoughts. And I really, really feel proud also to be here, to be present here. And thank you, Sriram, for inviting me for this event.
Thank you, ma'am. Pleasure, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am, for your words. Please let me introduce to you our guest for today, Ms. Rohina Gera. Ms. Gera completed her Bachelor of Arts from Stanford University, California, and Master of Finance from Sarah Lawrence College, New York. Ms. Gera has been working in the film and television industry since 1997. She started her career in development at Paramount Pictures, New York. Today, she is known for her prestigious contribution as a writer and director of various Indian films and television shows. Ma'am has written and directed Sir, which received critical acclaim as well as commercial success, with 24 awards around the world, including an award at Cannes Film Festival, Critics Week, and the Filmfare Award for Best Screenplay. Sir was released theatrically in over 25 countries, is one of the top 5 Hindi films that secured highest ticket sales in France ever. Upon its digital launch in India, Sir shot to number 1 position in Netflix for 5 straight days and remained in the top 10 for the next 34 days in India and other parts of the Asian subcontinent. Ms. Gera's micro-budget feature documentary, What's Love Got to Do With It, About Modern Indian Marriage, premiered at Mumbai Film Festival in 2013 and was the first documentary licensed by Netflix India. Her non-profit media work includes Stop the Hatred, to fight the hate propaganda that unfurled after 2002 Gujarat riots, featuring national icons from Sachin Tendulkar, Zakir Hussain, MF Hussain to Aamir Khan, Amitabh Bachchan, and Shabana Azmi. We welcome you, Ms. Gera, and are delighted to have you here with us. I would now like to formally begin the second part of our session and call upon our speaker, Ms. Rowena Gera. We are excited to learn from you, ma'am. The stage is all yours. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Kanisha. Thank you, Dr. Vidya, for your kind words. First, I just want to say I'm truly honored to be invited and to be here today. I'm really aware of the legacy of my grandfather, the relationship with my parents, and the depth and the duration of that relationship. But today I feel truly honored to be able to play a small part in that. Thank you, Dr. Gopakrishnan, for also thinking of me and inviting me. I know it's taken a lot of coordination and it's been a bit complicated with the pandemic and all these things, but finally we're here and I'm really excited to talk to the students particularly. I've been asked to talk a little bit about my journey, and it's interesting, you know, hearing you introducing me. You hear all these successful things, you know, the things that you put in a bio, everything that sounds good. And I thought that, you know, today, because the audience is young people, I thought back to my journey and to where it began, you know, around when I was your age. You know, maybe at the time when I was 20, 21, and I thought I'd start with a little story from that time, you know, to start to share a little bit about my journey. Now, this goes back to, I was about 20, 21 years old, and I was at Stanford, and I went to speak to my advisor, who was the head of the department, the head of the English department, and I had to go and tell him what my plans were. And I had decided that I wanted to continue doing a master's in creative writing. So I was going to submit my applications. And so this meeting was about that. So I go to meet him. His name was Dr. Leroux. And he was an accomplished writer in his own right, an author. So I go to him and I say, you know, Dr. Leroux, I've decided I want to do my master's in creative writing. And he takes a breath and he looks at me and he says, so you want to be a writer? And I said, I want to try to be a writer, you know, yes. And he said, you know, there are easier routes to unhappiness. So that was the first sort of inkling that I got of what was in store of the challenges, you know, when you set out to do something artistic or in a creative profession, the path isn't really easy. There isn't really a defined path and you have to really find your way. You know, you have to sort of beat your way through the jungle to figure out where you're going, who you are, what you want, you know, all these questions. So I'm not saying this at all to discourage you, you know, to make you feel that, oh, you shouldn't, you know, embark on this sort of a journey. It's extremely satisfying. It's extremely challenging. I can say it's never boring. But I think the question, you know, the question that I wanted to bring this to, this question of unhappiness, you know, when he said there are easier paths to unhappiness, you know, along the way, I've asked myself, what does that mean to say that, why are you unhappy with your journey, for instance? Because it takes time to get success. You know, these sort of careers are not, there isn't a path. So, it's not going to be like, okay, I got this job, I'm on the corporate ladder and I have measurable external success. You know, I'm getting a promotion or this or that. This is a very different journey. So it really raises the question as to what is success, you know, and that's something that I would like the students to think about, you know, what is success for you? Maybe you think, you know, if you're a journalism student and you think I want to be the next Faye D'Souza or, you know, I want to make the next big blockbuster Bollywood film, whatever. I think the thing is, it takes time. Those are all good goals. Your goal may be to make lots of money, fine. and you'll get there slowly. But along the way, when you don't, how do you keep going, right? What is it that you can, there are a lot of little steps on the way. And I think that in this journey, what I've really learned is that you have to learn for yourself to understand the little steps and to appreciate the progress you're making, even when the external success takes time to come, you know? And I think the most important thing is knowing why you're doing what you're doing. So if you say, I want to be a writer, you have to think about why, because it's not necessarily an easy journey. And if you know why you're doing what you're doing, specifically for a particular project and a bigger picture in your life, it's much easier to get through all the ups and downs, you know, because you have a goal, you know why you're doing what you're doing. Like, for instance, I mean, you mentioned Stop the Hatred, right? The nonprofit campaign. It was a time when I couldn't believe what was happening. I mean, like today, I couldn't believe what was happening in our country, the kind of the way that people were talking with so much of hatred, with, and that was becoming mainstream. And so my level of motivation was very high. I knew exactly what I wanted to do. And I had absolutely zero resources when I started, literally zero. Like, I had no idea how I was going to get this to happen, how I was going to even reach Amitabh Bachchan or finally Sachin Tendulkar. Or it's just that I knew why I had to do it. I knew why I had to try, and I didn't mind failing, you know? And then the universe conspired to help me, and I managed to cobble together a little money, and I managed to do it. But in that specific instance, I think there are things that really helped me. But, you know, along the journey, it doesn't mean that if you know why you want to do something, that it's going to be easy. You know, there are always steps along the way. So, for instance, I'm afraid actually that I'm going to scare the students, because I'm telling you all these things that are kind of, you know, difficult moments along the way. But I think that very often when you look at someone's bio, you only see the things that worked, you know. And I think it's really important to understand the journey. So I'm going to tell you about some of the other things that are not on my bio. So, for instance, like in 1998, and this is going to make me sound really old, but this was after my master's, I had a novel manuscript, and I was trying to, you know, I knew why I had written it, because I was trying to write something that was Indian and urban and pushing back against this whole idea of the exotic Indian, you know, these orientalist ideas about India. And I thought, I'm going to just write something urban and Indian, and why should it be, you know, why should there be, you know, agarbattis and, you know, billowing curtains and all this nonsense. I just wanted something very urban. And I never got the book published, because I took it to publishers in New York, and they said, oh, it's a good read, it's well written, but it's just not Indian enough, you know. And I came up against these sort of things where it wasn't Indian enough and it wasn't Western enough, and I was sort of in between. And but that was exactly why I was doing it, you know. So finding my way was very challenging. And then now, so 20 years later, when I made Sir, I took exactly the same risk again, because I was told before shooting the film that it was not commercial enough and not art house enough. So once again, I was going to be sitting between chairs, you know. I should either make it really commercial and get a star to play Ratna, or I should make it, you know, harsher and more sort of festively, you know. And again, I was in between, and I decided, no, I'm really going to do this. I'm going to do what I believe in, because there's a reason I'm doing this. I know why I'm doing this, and I'm going to go ahead and do it. And it was a huge risk, which, I mean, now when we look at it, it turned out great, because the film was able to reach people outside India. It's been able to reach people in India. It's been appreciated around the world. And I think that it's, you know, it's a similar risk I took in 1998 of doing something that's in between, and in you know, 2017 when this was made. And I think the difference is really the 20 years in between, I learned a lot, you know. There was a lot of learning and struggling and figuring out of things. So that, yeah, I knew not only why I'm doing what I'm doing, but how I was going to do it, you know? So I think that when you have a lot of setbacks sometimes, you know, you have a lot of setbacks through this process, through the artistic process or through the journey of trying to find your way, you think that, oh, you're not getting where you want to be. But I think you're really learning a lot. You know, all the years of trying to, find my way, you know, working in Bombay, working as a writer, writing films I didn't necessarily understand, things that I'm not really proud of, you know, it wasn't easy. But I think I learned what I liked, what I didn't like, how to go about doing things, the craft of it. And all along, I never found, my biggest frustration was that I never found a director who I connected with well enough to really be excited about giving them my next script. And that was a huge source of frustration and a huge difficulty for me in the years that I was working in Bombay. But you know what? The secret is that actually, if I had found that director, I would have never become a director, you know? So I decided to direct my own film and trust myself and make what I really believed in and what I wanted to make because of that setback, because of the fact that I never found the director that I was looking for, you know, for whom I could do the writing. And so I could discover the joy of directing, of collaborating, of making my own film. And I also realized that I had been doing the hardest part all these years, which is writing, you know, and the direction is just so much fun. And it's so collaborative and it's so enriching to work with people and not be locked in a room, banging your head against a wall when the script isn't going well. So, you know, it's through all these years of trying to find something, and then you realize, no, I'm just going to do this myself, you know? So I think if there's one thing that I would want to leave people with today, it's really this thought. I mean, I know we hear it in many different ways that things happen for the best, but really, I think sometimes these setbacks can really be a blessing in disguise, you know? And I think one has to, things take time. And if you hang in there and you know why you're doing what you're doing, you can keep at it. But it's not just about saying, oh, I have a dream and I'm going to do this overnight. I think you have to really commit to it, work at it, and learn and grow through the process, you know? And I think, and you need a lot of luck. So if things don't work out right away, I think you have to have, be kind to yourselves, I think, that, you know, things take time. So that's all that I have to say for now. And I'm happy to take questions which are more specifically about Sir or about whatever you would like to talk about. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Rohina, ma'am, for that. I would now like to call upon Hannah to moderate the question answer session.
A very good afternoon to everyone present here. My name is Hannah Sarsujan from Batch 22. Although it is a pity that we're meeting on this Zoom session and not in our auditorium, we're more than thrilled to have the opportunity to interact with Ms. Rohina Guerra about the ideation, the writing, and the making of her recent film, Sir Is Love Enough. When we announced the event, we were flooded with questions from both students and faculty who have thoroughly enjoyed the film. However, because of the lack of time, with Ms. Guerra, we have curated a few questions for the session. With your permission, ma'am, we'd like to begin the question answer session. We look forward to hearing your insights about the filmmaking experience. Our first question is from Abhishek Anand from Batch 22.
Hello. Good afternoon, ma'am. Good afternoon, sir.
Hi.
Hello, ma'am. My question to you is that Sir as a movie seems to have been written for Tilottama's show. Was she your first casting choice?
It wasn't written for her, actually. I didn't have her in my mind while I was writing, but she was my first casting choice. Once the writing process was completed and I was thinking about who to cast, it's actually the producer, who's also my husband, who was like, what about Tilottama? And then once I got her into my head, I couldn't get her out. Like, I just felt she was it. And I was really nervous, actually, that she would say no. Because, you know, she's played a maiden monsoon wedding and I thought she may not want to do it again. But luckily, she liked the script and it was very smooth from there.
She was like, she was the perfect person to cast. It was, yeah, brilliant. The next question we have was from is from Vasudha Chatterjee from batch 21.
Hello, ma'am. Hello, sir. I personally found Sir to be a very nuanced film. And one of the most commendable aspects about it is, you know, the absence of an upper class gaze, which is otherwise very, very prevalent in mainstream Bollywood cinema. So how did you convert that thought into film form, including scripting? Like, what was the pre-production process like?
So I wasn't really aware of an upper class gaze or otherwise. Like, I was just trying to be with the character, you know, and when I write also, it's very character driven. I was trying to be as truthful to her as I could. And also when I was writing, I didn't know where the film was going to go. So I had this person and I was trying to figure out who she is and who he is, and then what could potentially happen in this space, you know? So it wasn't, maybe that's part of the reason, because it wasn't a plot that was imposed on these two people. So then they are sort of moving around by my design. They were kind of evolving in their own way, you know? And her aspirations and her dreams, it's sort of the way that I see people, it's the people I've seen in my life, you know? And how, who I find personally very inspiring, you know, that resilience. So, and what was your other question in terms of pre-production?
Yeah, I mean, so I was asking that in order to, you know, overcome that upper class gaze, how did you go about the entire thing? Yeah.
I mean, I think it's working from the inside out, really trying to get to know the person, the character, not my relationship to them because I'm upper class and I, you know, but from her point of view, what is life? Who am I from her point of view, right? And that's something I've always been aware of in life, right? You know, one is you are aware that, you know, when you're paying for a pizza or something that you order, that it's a lot of money, you know, for someone else. So it's just that the just being aware from somebody else's point of view.
Right.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. The next question is from Ria Thorat. From batch of 21. Ria?
So ma'am, in the film, I noticed that there are several instances where the character of Ratna takes off her slippers and she carries them in her hand. And this happens quite a lot of times, at least 3 to 4 times. So ma'am, please could you tell me why this certain action was emphasized?
So this is, again, based on observation, right? A lot of people, staff, because they're out and about and, you know, they take off their chappals before they enter the house because they would potentially be dusty. And maybe you'll notice this out in buildings like that, the chappals are left outside when they enter in a lot of buildings. But in this particular case, the reason she doesn't leave them outside is because it's not, doesn't look nice. So she has been requested by Ashwin's mom in the past. Ashwin wouldn't think of such a thing, but because she's been trained by the mom, she's been told that you take off your chappals, but you keep it in your room. You don't leave it, you know, in the front of the house because it doesn't look nice. If guests come, you know, someone's chappals are lying outside. Also because she lives in the house, right? When you have the people who come and go, the workers who come and go, they usually leave the chappals out. They come and do their jharu pocha, and they take the chappal and they go, you know? So it's very much about it's just sort of detailing of just everyday life, you know, in Bombay.
Thank you so much, Ria. The next question we have is from Suprasanna from batch of 21.
Ma'am, the favorite part I found was the way you used a wall to show the difference between the world of Ratna and Ashwin. I mean, it was really nice. So what was the process of coming up with this visual metaphor?
Okay, so that's a great question, actually, because it was the wall, for me, the wall actually links and separates them, right? You see that they actually, you know, there's a human thing between them where they're both watching TV, they're both alone, but they're connected, but they're separated. And the original idea was not actually that. The original idea was something completely different. Initially, I wanted an exterior shot of the building with a bigger window, you know, where he's watching in his, and the small window into the kitchen where she's watching or into the room, you know. And I wanted an external wall with these two windows, just lit in a dark building. But of course, that wasn't possible because you have so many different challenges in trying to shoot in Bombay, and I could, there was no way of getting that kind of a setup. So this was the solution on set, you know, which I, when I was talking to Dominique Collin, who's the director of photography, and I said, Dominique, can we go through the wall, you know? And I didn't know the word in French because we speak in French. And he said, well, we're not traveling. I said, yeah, can we, you know, can we trolley through the wall? And he said, yeah, totally, we can do that. And then we started to, you know, decide that. And then we added one extra shot of that when we were on set, and we said, oh, we can do it this way. So it evolved, which is why, you know, I think, which is what I said earlier, that collaboration and working with good people is just such a joy, you know, because when you're sitting alone and you think, oh, I'll have these two windows and all, but then when you get on set and you know, it was one of my requirements from the location manager that I want these two windows. I mean, they were like, shoot on a set then. And I was like, no, I don't want to shoot on a set. I want to shoot in a real place in South Bombay, not in Powai, and I want these two windows. And so I couldn't get it all. But it came up, you know, like sometimes I think some strains throw up solutions, which is what's great about it.
Thank you so much. How is that, you spoke about your director of photography. How was their experience shooting in India? Was it their first time in shooting in Bombay?
Yeah, it was. I had my DOP and first AC. So the director of photography and his first assistant were both French. And also the sound recordist and assistant were French. My DOP was amazing. He loved it. He was really, and he was able to work the way we work. You know, we work really long hours, and we're very, you know, we don't really care about what time you came and is it 12 hours or 10 hours and what is your shift and all. You know, we just kind of get the work done. And he has that same spirit, and he's very quick. So he was wonderful. The sound recordist had a much harder time. You know, I think one of the people had seen Mumbai on a map, and I thought, oh, it's by the sea. So on the days off, I'll go to the beach or something. I don't know what she had in her head. So one of the people actually didn't make it through the shoot. She left. She just found it too polluted, too difficult, too long hours, like it's too hot. These people are crazy. And so she left and we had to replace her. So she was the boom operator. So it didn't affect me directly much because I don't have to collaborate with her directly. But yeah, the key people were amazing. So that was good.
Wonderful. So the next question we have is from our faculty. Is Supriti ma'am? Can we have?
Yeah. Hi, Rohina. First of all, I'm really glad that you told them the anecdotes behind the bio. I think it's really good that you're providing them with like practical perspective of being a filmmaker and being a writer. Yeah, there's a quiet in your film. You know, most people will show Bombay as this fast-paced, bustling city, noisy, and even your market scene is not noisy. So I just want to know, is that something that you consciously avoided? And if yes, then why?
Ma'am, your mic is muted. Yeah, your mic is muted.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
No problem.
I think it's a quiet film overall. Like the tonality of the film is very interior, but we didn't actually turn down the market noise in particular. I think it was just in continuity with the film. You know, with the, I can't see the professor who asked me the question. Is it possible to see her? It's very difficult to talk to my
Sorry, friend. I'm slightly the camera shy kind of person.
Okay. No, because otherwise I'm talking to myself and it's so hard.
Okay,
I mean,
okay.
I'm not very good with even the whole presentation. I have to just talk to myself. It's very difficult. yeah, but it's, I think it's, it was not intentional to make it particularly quiet. I think it was just consistent with the emotional themes of the film. So I think the market scene, you do see there is some amount of noise, and our sound recorders really struggled with the overall level of noise. You know, so I think everything was brought down in a certain way because everything is light shot. You know, it's not So to make all the other sounds audible, and we were really focused on sounds like, you know, her bangles and, you know, being able to hear all the little details. So to do that, I think we had to bring the overall just noise level of Bombay, the honking and this and that, had to bring it down. And then I think in the mix and stuff, it's more a question of making it coherent, you know. But I don't really have a clever thing to that. It was just the tone of the film. No.
Right.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Our next question is from R. Shweta from batch 22. Shweta?
Yes, ma'am. Hi, ma'am. Hi, sir. Hi. So my question is that this film subverts the idea of love as sort of an equalizer. Their problems are still very real. And the real sort of equalizer is the sense of agency that comes from a chance at upward mobility. So can you tell us a little bit about like Ratna's agency and just about this?
Actually, I'm curious about what you're saying. Feel that love is not an equalizer, that she is more the agency comes from the fact that she gets an opportunity.
My question is about the fact that, you know, it is more focused on her agency. Like Ratna still wants to, you know, grab her chance at upward mobility rather than love, right? And it just doesn't focus on, okay, she's in love, the story doesn't end there. The story goes on to, like, she wants to pursue her dream in tailoring and she looks for her job and she leaves love. So can you tell us more about what you thought of when you were thinking of Ratna's agency?
Yeah, sure. Okay. You know, I think, you know, I wanted to bring into question this whole idea also of privilege, right? There's this assumption that privilege equals happiness, you know, or there's a lot of these kinds of ideas. Or also, I mean, love stories are really irritating also to me sometimes, because it's not like just because there's no happily ever after kind of thing. You know what I mean? Like, it's really important. I really believe in love, but I think that it's important to each individual is an individual. You know, and especially today, you know, a woman is not just about a love story. So there's obviously that aspect that she is who she is. And I think I just wanted to turn on its head this idea that he is better off. I mean, he's not some prince who's saving her. If anything, she's saving him, because she is showing him that you can have a dream and you can have hope and you don't have to be trapped in this gilded cage. You know, he's in his gilded cage and she's free. And, you know, there's a way in which you assume that he's better off, but actually she's better off because she has a dream. She is motivated, you know, she's fighting for something and that gives her hope. And I think what makes a person alive or happy is having hope, is working for something, is looking forward to something, you know. It's not just, I mean, being trapped in your fancy car or being trapped in your fancy house. So he's always, you know, even in like sort of this sort of ivory tower or gilded cage kind of situations where you feel her freedom. She's out and about and she's alive. And I think it's about those things that, you know, who are we to assume that we, and by we, I mean all of us who are privileged, are happier? I'm not trying to say that, oh, you know, so people are, you know, it, without being judgmental, each person has their own journey, you know? And so I didn't want any kind of savior complex. You know, earlier somebody asked me about this upper class gaze. I didn't want it to be about that. It's really about looking at a person as a person, not as a role that they play in your life, not in how you see them or what you would feel if you were in that position. You know, for her, Bombay is all about is liberating. It's exciting. It's new. She can make herself as a person instead of being a widow in the village. And for him, Bombay is a place he's come back to and he's trapped in because he's back with his family. He's back in that, you know, so it's different things for different people. So yeah, I'm saying many different things at the same time, but there's all these layers in what I was thinking about. I hope that answers you somewhat.
It does. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next question is coming from Bedouria, sir.
Hi, am I audible?
Yes.
Okay, actually, a part of my question you have already answered, so I will modify my question a bit. First thing that I noticed, I mean, as a sort of professor of film, reader of film, the intersection of class and gender is quite unmistakable in your film. So, but in from that perspective, but the first question that came to my mind is that I felt that there is a general underplaying of Ratna's sexuality. So was that a conscious decision, and was that a part of like your reaction to what you want to present about this question of savior complex, etc.? And the second thing I wanted to talk about is that, you know, at the end of the film, of course, we get a sense that, you know, Ratna is doing this because from a position of certain kind of self-respect, because, you know, to meet Ashwin on equal grounds beyond the master-servant kind of power dynamics. But it also has this, you know, we also know that she's also doing it because of this sort of log kya kahenge kind of a problem. But and then she takes a job at the fashion designer's company through Ashwin's connection, which kind of seems to nullify that sense of, you know, coming out of this power dynamic and, you know, really meeting on an equal basis. Was that sort of slight messiness or like, you know, unresolvedness of the tension, was that conscious on your part? I mean, that's what you wanted to present. So these are the two questions, the underplaying of the sexuality in the relation on Ratna's part, and that end. That's my question.
I think, well, I'll talk about the second part first, the second question first, which is about the end. I think it's not theoretical for her. Mm-hmm. It's not log kya kahenge, and as if she has a choice. She knows that there is absolutely no way that she can be with him. She knows the society, it has been brutal to her. So she has no illusions that, and if she takes a job, it is not in order to then therefore be eligible to be with him. If she gets a break, she's going to take it. You know, there's not one is not in a position of privilege to say, "Nee, I won't take it if it comes from you." You know, it's she's extremely motivated. She knows he's doing it because he cares about her. He offers to help her in some other way. She says no to that because she won't take cash. She won't take a, you know, but he's given her a foot in the door. And I think if for all the kids here who are going to work in media as well, the value of a foot in the door, it's priceless, but you've got to prove yourself, right? It's really, really difficult to get a foot in the door. But after that, it's not a gift. You have to then work. So to my mind, and then if you look at it from his character's point of view, he could not possibly just leave and do nothing. You know, for me, I needed that man to do something for her, to try to in some way or form, but with full respect towards who she is, and not trying to give her a gift of money and say, okay, now you can set up your own tailoring shop, I'll rent this shop for you, or I'll give you this or that. He can't do that because that would be really a real lack of respect. But what can he do? Just leave with his tail between his legs? No, he's going to do something. He's going to try in some way or form to just get that little opening, because he knows she will shine. With half an opportunity, she will find her way. And that's all he does. So to my mind, I don't think that in any way or form, he doesn't want to undermine her. He respects her. And all he's doing is giving her a little foot in the door so that she has a chance to prove herself. Because he's seen her. He's seen what she can do. She's given him a shirt. He's seen that she has an eye. She's trying to do things. You see what I'm saying? So I think that if you look at it from each of their points of view, without a theoretical approach that we have, you know, a privileged approach that we have, ki, theoretically, would this person do that? No. If I'm in a position where I get a break, I'm going to grab that break, you know, as Ratna. And if I'm the guy who's in love with this woman, then I'm not going to just leave like that, you know? So it was trying to find what each character would do or could do in those circumstances, given the society within which they live, you know? So I don't see it as, personally, I don't see it as messy, you know, as a resolution, because I needed him to do something. He couldn't just leave. And about the sexuality, I think that was a conscious sort of, well, there's two things. I really wanted restraint. I really admire restraint in films. I find it often a bit annoying because you straight away have, you know, in a lot of films, you have two people kiss and then you see them waking up in bed the next morning. And I just find that, I like the sustained desire. I think it's enjoyable on screen, you know, waiting, hoping, will something happen, won't something happen. I think that's the most beautiful, those are the most beautiful moments. So I wanted to enjoy that. And I think also she's very aware of the consequences. I mean, even a kiss is just shattering. It just sort of breaks everything in their lives. So I didn't want to go down that path, which is what I think. It's also a male gaze thing. It's also, you know, over-sexualizing, a lower class character, which has been done to death. I mean, Tirotama often talks about this in her interviews. If any of you have seen any of her interviews, that she was trying to research her character and she started looking up references and all she found was porn, you know, because this is sort of hyper-sexualized imaging and, you know, power dynamics and all these things. So I was really keen to step away from that and also allow us to fall in love with her as a person, not as an object, you know, get to know her and fall in love with her and to justify that why, how would he fall in love with her, you know, which is why also in terms of casting, you know, it's not somebody who's sort of voluptuous and it's someone who you fall in love with over a period of time, you know, as the person. So, yeah, I mean, I think good. I hope that answers.
Yeah, perfectly. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. I'd also like to point out that evolving dynamic of, like, I understand that was like one of my main fears when I first read about the film, that it would hypersexualize a woman in, say, a more vulnerable position, and the dynamic that would like emerge from that kind of thing would be such an oppressive dynamic, yeah. Right? So I really, really loved that particular aspect in the film.
Anna, I can ask a question or one question.
Sure, sure.
You know, just when you see, fine, Tirotama is fine, is great there, but I also like Vivek in that. That sustained depressive mood that he continued, which slowly tapered off over a period of time. But when you wrote that character, if he was not from United States, if he had not spent time in United States, would he have reacted to another woman with equal dignity, unlike another person who was born in India and who's seen maid servants being used as servants?
You know, I've been. Are you done with the question? Were you still speaking?
Yeah. Yeah, that's fine. Only difference is the when you wrote the character, he had to be from United States and come back to India rather than somebody who's born here, who might not treat the maidservant the way he did. Because probably he is exposed to a much more open society where respect is given to people who work, whatever work you do, that kind of dynamic might be there. So probably that you had in mind, an Indian person might not have fit in there. An Indian kind of a person.
Yeah. I think it's a good question, Dr. Gopakrishnan, because, you know, I'm not sure. Like, I can't say for sure because this is the character that I decided to write about, and that's not why I made him foreign returned or America returned. It's because of many other reasons as well. But the thing is that in the beginning, when we first meet him and her, he doesn't treat her any differently than anybody else. She's invisible. And the only difference, I think, is that he's respectful towards her. He's polite. He's decent. He's not a jerk to her. You know, he doesn't shout and all that. But he's not, he doesn't see her. She's completely invisible to him. Which is what I think. And I think that can be the case with any decent Indian man. He doesn't have to be, have studied in America. He can be respectful. He can be decent. He can be, and I know a lot of guys like that. If you know my friends in Bombay and all, who are very respectful. The prospect of falling in love with that person is out of the range of possibility, you know, even for the most progressive guys that I know. So the journey of the film was really to say, okay, somebody who's respectful, who treats this person well, what happens when you start to push down those barriers a little bit? What happens when you start to actually see the person, when you start to appreciate her as a human being, as a friend, you know, what if? Also, you know, the other question is, he's in a particularly vulnerable place in his life, you know, because of the breakup, because he feels completely isolated, because nobody in his family understands him, and this woman does. It's that, you know. So of course, even if he was from America or whatever, but if he hadn't had this breakup, he would have perhaps not ever seen her. She would continue to just be the hand that brings the chai or the hand that lays the table, you know, not a person. So I think it's, I would hope, to answer your question, I would hope that it's that Indian men born and raised in India, studying in India and living in India could also be respectful and could also contemplate seeing this woman as a full person, you know, and all the possibilities that go with that, not necessarily, you know, a physical or sexual or a romantic relationship, but just to actually see people for who they are, you know.
Great. I have next one is not a question, just an observation. I like the tailor very much, you know. He makes her come regularly. Very, very, you know, typical of this mentorship thing. You know, they, you come to my place, you do all the dirty work, and, you know, then I'll teach you how to do things. I like that tailor. Hannah, please continue the question.
Thank you, sir. Bachchan Pachera is the actor. He's a very senior actor, and I really liked him also.
Yeah, very good. You know, that sequence was very, very different. It ran differently, at least 2-3 sequences which went on. And at every stage, he promoted her regularly from picking up the old thing to cutting stuff. Yeah, Hannah, please continue.
Right. The next question is from Ahan. Ahan Sen from Batch 22.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes.
Hi, so my question is regarding something that Hannah brought up earlier, and I think even you talked about a little bit, which is the fact that many among the Sir crew are not Indian, like you talked about your DOP and I think even your first AD. And if I'm not wrong, even your co-producer is, I think, not Indian. So my question was, with regards to independent filmmaking, what exactly is the difference between having an Indian producer and a foreign producer in terms of like producing the film and like promoting it?
Yeah, that's a great question. So for me personally, because I have spent a lot of time in and out of India, I feel like I'm 100% Indian, but I also have a perspective from having lived away, you know. So the way that I see these characters, for instance, is deeply influenced by the fact that I've also lived away. So I do see the cracks in our society, but I'm part of it. So for me personally, it was interesting to be able to collaborate. Like, for instance, I'll talk about these two things separately, creative collaboration and a producer, you know. So to be able to collaborate creatively, for instance, with Dominique Collin, it was really wonderful because he got it. Like for me, because I've lived away, as much as I still appreciate the colors and the chaos of the markets, that when I'm in India for longer, I don't see it as much, you know. I don't notice it because it becomes normal. The brightness of our saris, the colors that we wear, it becomes normal. So it was nice to work with somebody who could also see that, because a lot of this was just grabbed on the go. You know, we were shooting in live locations and stuff. So to actually get the tone of it, to get that feeling of like, when, for instance, when she's in the coming out in of the station in Dadar, you know, when she's walking, it's in the title sequence. I mean, those are shots that we didn't really have any control on the crowd. We just had to shoot, you know. But that getting that tone and that mood and the crowd really appreciating and enjoying that was, I think, possible because of the collaboration with somebody who sees things, who's seeing India also for the first time, in a way. But I'm not seeing India for the first time. So together we could create something that is enjoyable in both ways, you know. That's not seeing it from the outside like, oh, look how fascinating. But at the same time, still, you know, showing something that I think is charming about our home. So that was on the creative side. And on the production side, I think it's challenging, right? Because Indian producers very often will say that, look, it's more expensive, because when you collaborate my post-production was also done outside India, which makes it more expensive. So we ended up getting some funding from the CNC. To help towards post-production costs, but it's very uncertain. So it's a very difficult, treacherous path to go down. And Indian producers will normally tell you, look, make it in this budget. We don't need your French co-producer. We don't need all that. Let's just do it this way, you know, because we can control it. Why do we want to deal with these foreigners? They'll become more expensive. It'll be more expensive. You hear a lot of that. And for me, I was just clear that I wanted it to be collaborative. I wanted to... the kind of learning and the kind of perspective that could bring, because even the edit, right, even the sound design, These are all things that were defined a lot by the people you collaborate with, you know, as much as there are amazing editors in India, right? But I because of the co-production, you have to then do your post-production in France. But I was able to work with a really senior French editor who, with his eye for detail and with, you know, the tempo that we were able to do and the rhythm and being able to hold a shot just till the door closes, those are things that may have gotten done a little bit earlier, done a little bit differently. So I think it can, if your feeling towards the film is very international, then it helps to have that kind of collaboration, you know? But that said, you never know. Like I said earlier, I was sort of going down this path and it could have been a film that is not festival-y enough and is not commercial enough and nobody saw, you know? I was really aware of that, that it could happen that, you know, it's going to be my parents and my friends who watch this movie. And I'm going to have to say sorry to everybody who funded it. And that's it. You know, it's really, really risky to go down this kind of path because it's not the most practical path, but it allows it to be international. When you bring in an international perspective, it matters, you know, because the way we see things, the way that we see films, the way that we are all steeped in, no matter what, right? There's quite a huge shadow of Bollywood over all media that happens in Bombay. So in order to break out of that, if you really want to do something that's truly independent and that's truly a different voice, for me, it was very helpful to bring in other kinds of people, you know?
In your past experiences, have you seen a difference between, say, something with a more international perspective versus something with, say, a more documentary-esque feel? Do you think that it helped in terms of distributing and like marketing it as a film to international audiences as well?
I didn't understand the first part, documentary-ish.
A more Indian feel of a film versus an international perspective.
So I'll give you an example. I think it was, I keep giving these dates and then people are going to think I'm really old. But like maybe 2013, I think I was in Film Bazaar. I think it was around then or a little bit earlier. And LSD had come out, you know. And I think Dibakar was lamenting that it had not had a good international career. You know, he was on a panel and he was saying, I don't know why. But if I look at that film, I can see exactly why. Like for India, it's edgy and interesting. It's not interesting to an international audience, you know. And that's just in terms of, because it's not in their context of what they see at a festival or what they see in their range of experience. It's not something that is new or truly edgy, you know, interesting. So I think it does help in terms of outreach, bringing in that perspective, but also in a very practical sense, of course it helps, because if your film does get into a festival and then you have a co-producer who's sitting in France and who can help with those contracts with a sales agent, who can help to, I mean, I had a sales agent and a French distributor before the film was even selected at Cannes, you know, because my co-producer was like, you know, I mean, actually we did that because we thought this film has no hope of getting into a festival. Probably it's a bit too, my co-producer thought that it was probably a bit too like frivolous. He said, this is definitely not going to get into Cannes. So maybe we should start to talk to the commercial side in France first, you know? So he reached out to a couple of people that he knew, and luckily we got really positive feedback from a couple of people. And so the film got picked up before it got selected at Cannes. So that, you know, we had that sort of security, because otherwise, you know what happens, I don't know, whenever you guys get there, you'll see, sometimes you make a film and you submit it to a festival and then you're sitting there and you're praying to the festival gods, ki kuch ho jai, kuch ho jai. I hope somebody takes my film, because that is the only hope of getting an independent film on an international platform, you know. But when you have a co-producer who can talk to people in advance or look into sales in advance, and that can even happen to an Indian producer who knows the ropes, or who knows how to do this. In my particular case, I've only made one film, but in my particular case, that was very helpful, you know.
Right. Very much so. All right. The next question that we have is from Purnima Priyadarshini from Batch 22. Purnima?
Hello, ma'am. Hello, sir. In showcasing the narrative of Ratna in Sir, bring forth an unusual female agency that most Indian films lack in general. In that light, what are some other similar films you would recommend?
Oh, I don't know. I'm very bad with this sort of thing. Like really, I'm really, really bad with recommending films, especially around, I don't know, Dr. Gopalakrishnan, can you help? Can you help me?
I think similar, can you just repeat that question?
Okay, like how like Ratna's narrative is like very, you know, brings forth an unusual female agency that in most Indian films that particular thing lacks. So if we will look at that particular thing, then what other films was that same female agency representation in them?
See, I here I don't know about female agency, but Baiduria, you must have had similar examples, no? You must be having some
okay.
Relations. Fine. This is called a swing film, ball, you know.
One just... film I can recommend to you guys, which we teach. I used to teach in the third. Here also, which is a very famous film called Ali, Fear Eats Soul, by Rainer Werner Fassbinder, a German director, which is again about the story of a middle-aged, almost old woman. She works in an office as a maid, and she meets this Arabic sort of illegal immigrant, who is a worker in a sort of car shop. And the sort of uneasy romance blooms between the two, but the society, I mean, you know, Germany, racism. So it's a film about racism, ageism, and all sorts of nuances of that issue within which the romance works, it's an extremely famous film. It won the Cannes Award, I think, in 1973 or 74. So when I was watching Sir, it was kind of reminding Ali. Most probably because I teach that film. But I mean, you can look into that film. It's a good film.
I also would like to change that question maybe a little bit and ask you what your inspirations or filmic inspirations and were. Say in your early years, or even now.
Don't say early years. Yeah, again, you're making me sound like I don't know. coming back to this thing, I feel for the longest time I felt very apologetic about the fact that actually I'm not very good at this sort of referencing. It's just not how I function. And so now I realize that. So I just say it up front, like it's really not how I function. There are a lot of films I love, but I really draw from life, you know. For me, I'm not really sort of inspired by a film to make another film, but I will say this, that in Sir, I think that the one film that really had got under my skin, and particularly the music and the mood, and it comes back to the mention of restraint, was In the Mood for Love. You know, because it already has that sort of heightened reality and these really heightened moments and music. So for that, yes, you know, definitely there was, I used to listen to that music, you know, and it also allowed me to be kind of over the top romantic in a certain way, you know, and like there's a lot of restraint in the film, in the two characters, but for me to actually go down that path, it was very helpful to have that kind of over-the-top emotion that music allows. I don't know if that makes any sense if people are writers in the audience, but it's that kind of feeling, you know. So it's a more of an emotional journey. Something may get under your skin or it may not. And sometimes it's really just drawing from life and trying to find your own tone, which is what is actually so hard about it, about the writing process, you know, finding your own way. It's not fitting into something, you know.
Absolutely. Yeah. The next question that we have is from Krishanu Bose, also from Batch 22.
Hello, ma'am. My question is like, while writing, sir, how did you balance the English and the Hindi dialogues in the movie? because I thought it was extremely very natural and organic. Like, it fitted very well in the plot. So, like, how did you, like, is there a method that you followed while writing it?
No, I mean, it's exactly what you said. It's just what they would do. I tried to follow what would be natural to them. So actually, I was really keen that also that Tilottama had to learn Marathi for the role, because I wanted her to speak to her sister in Marathi, because that's what she would do. You know, she's a Maharashtrian girl from the village. She'd speak to her sister in Marathi. She'd speak to her, to people, you know, in Bombay. She's learned Hindi. So it was what I felt they would do, as truthful. I mean, the whole journey of this film was trying to be as truthful, as honest as possible to these people, you know, to these characters, and how they, and I tried to make them speak the way I felt they would speak, you know, and yeah. So, and also, you know, there's all the, it's not designed to do it, but it's just the way our society is. So it does reflect the kind of classism as well, the way that English operates, the way that people speak English, assuming usko samajh mein nahi aayega, you know, we can say whatever we want, but how much do they really understand, you know, when you're in the car and the driver's listening, does he understand that? There's all these things that are always going on, right, in our society. So that I wanted that to exist in the film the way it exists in life. And so it was, there wasn't, I didn't design it as such like that. I think it's just how we are. So it was just trying to be true to that. You know, I don't know that answers you, but.
Yes, ma'am, you answered. Thank you.
Thank you, Krishanu. The next question we have is from Juhi Rajwani, a member of our faculty. Juhi, ma'am.
Hi, Rohina. You've answered this question quite a lot, but let me rephrase it. Do you think the film would have been received well if it were the story of a middle-class man and his house health? We've been talking about how, you know, you wanted to stay away from the hyper-sexualized house health, you know, the upper-class gaze and everything. Placing the characters of Vivek and Ratna in a particular class context, was that a conscious choice?
So you're asking me that if I changed him to being less upper class and to being more middle class?
Yeah. Would that have worked? You know, especially with the audiences. I mean, so the question comes from the context that, you know, these breaking barrier sort of stories are probably, you know, this is the assumption, and correct me if I'm wrong, but when it comes to the masses, there's a certain kind of audience that finds it digestible, or rather acceptable. You know, when you're looking at societal structures and norms as to log kya bolenge, you think the film would have been, you know, equally well received if it were not so upper class?
So that's interesting. So for you, it would be harder for a middle class person than for an upper class person. You feel that they have certain permissions that middle class people have more controls.
Yeah, so because class with itself brings some sort of openness to progressive ideas, right?
Right. I hadn't thought of that, perfectly honest. I think I can't tell you what an audience would. I really didn't know. You know, I really fought to bring the film to India, and I was really frightened that it would be totally rejected because it would make people uncomfortable, irritated, or whatever. So I didn't know till the first week of Jan when the film released on Netflix what was going to really happen. So I can't tell you what I think would happen if it was slightly different, because I genuinely don't know. But what I've understood through this process of how people are relating and the kind of feedback and the kind of letters I get and everything is that it's connecting to people on a very human, very visceral, emotional level. So I think that whether if that connect happens and people are willing to suspend their lives and actually be with your characters fully, my hope would be that whether it's middle class or upper class or whatever, if you connect with the humans and the humanity of the people on screen, hopefully it would. I don't know, but again, you can't say, you can never say what an audience, I mean, and I think the minute you start to think you know what the audience wants, you're in trouble, you know.
But in that case, then choosing to place a Vivek Gomez character in that strata, was that a conscious decision, or it just came naturally because that was the story in your head as a writer?
I think it was, I wanted the contrast to be really sharp, you know, And I wanted, for me, it was really, because that's also how I see Bombay, and Bombay is another character for me in the film, you know, and Bombay is really a city of contrast, right? So to me, it was interesting that this woman comes in, you know, from the village, you see her whole journey, and then you see her entering this house, and then, you know, so it's really about the sharp contrast that we live with and we take for granted, and these two completely disparate worlds within one home. So in the very conception of the film, it was about contrast, you know, as sharp as they can be. So I didn't want to, visually, it was much more interesting for me to have the contrast be extreme, you know. So I didn't consider it, I didn't think of it any other way, because it was really about extreme contrast. And that's why I really wanted a beautiful apartment for him, you know. Also, it's visually pleasing, you know, having him on this, also the high rise, the feeling of isolation. There are all these things that could come in. I mean, of course, you don't think of all of that at once, but somewhere in the very birth of the idea was the contrast in within one home, you know, the extreme contrast within one home. There's that one wall, and then they, you know, so I think a middle class would have been a bit more familiar on both sides, a bit closer in terms of certain things, you know, even how you eat. I wanted that contrast, you know. Your mom can never accept her because she will not eat with a fork and knife, you know. So those kind of sharp contrasts could only come with this kind of class difference, you know?
I particularly recall the way she's setting up the trays for breakfast and laying the table. It's so elaborate there.
Yeah,
I think that's what we're talking about.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. I mean, I think they all thought I was a bit nutty on set because I was so specific about, you know, the correct spoon and the correct, but it's really about that, right? How she knows how to do all this, but she will eat in her thali, you know, like, and it's really how we live, you know?
Right. Thank you so much, Apna. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. The next question is from Amuli Berevar from batch 2022. Amoli? Okay, I think Amoli is having some technical issues, so I'll just read this question out.
Hi. Sorry, I was unable to unmute myself.
Perfect.
Okay, so my question is that
you
mentioned
on the video, Amoli?
I am not able to. It's saying that the host has stopped.
Okay, fine.
So my question is that you mentioned it earlier as well, that the background score in the film is very subtle and nuanced. So what was your thought process behind, you know, designing the feel and the nature of the background score?
So I'm so happy you asked about the background score, because it was really a fun collaboration and really also very challenging, because so the songs are done by an Indian composer, but the background music is done by a French musician. And he works a lot with, you know, synthesizers, and he does, you know, background music for fashion shows and things like that also. And we were trying to find the right music for the film. And at first he got really excited. He said, oh, it's an Indian film. I'm going to work with tablas and sitar and all. He was very, very excited to try, you know, to play with these instruments in his compositions. And I was like, I don't know, let's see, because, you know, sitar right away, it's so distinctive that it's very difficult to use it in a way that doesn't take you into like the suddenly like a village idea. You know, when you hear the sound, it immediately evokes something else.
And also an Indian cliche.
Yeah, exactly. 100%. So, you know, he said, no, but we tried it didn't work. Then we tried, you know, things like, you know, a space that he was more comfortable in. And I said, no, I don't think strings and cello and violin and all also is not the sound of this film. And I really like flute music. I really like jazz. So I was sending him all these references of Hariprasad Chaurasia and then Melody Gaudovo and all these different things. And we were trying to find a sound that was like sort of modern, but Indian, but from these people. And he was really, really a wonderful collaborator, because he would just keep sending me options and keep trying things, and we kept going until we finally found how to make it work, you know, in a way that's layered, in a way that has this and then I really wanted flute, so we managed to record live flute for some of the sections. There was a flautist called Rishabh Prasanna, who was in Paris at the time. He was touring, so Pierre Avia, who's the composer, managed to get a hold of him. We got him into a studio in Paris, and we managed to record the flute. So it was really fun. It was really collaborative. It was really fun, and I was really happy with it personally because I felt like the sound came from these characters. Like, it was organic to the film. It was organic to how I felt the moments of the film. You know, it wasn't imposed in the way that it was feeling. If you try to do, you know, strings or other sort of more Western instrumentation somehow. And nor was it too Indian or falling into the Indian cliche. So it was quite a struggle. Not a struggle, it was just a fun collaboration, a lot of back and forth and stuff, but it was really fun. And the music is out and you can listen to it if you like it. It's on Spotify. If you look up Pierre Avia, he's put it up, so you can listen to it. Thanks, Amoli.
Thank you.
Our next question is from Yashvi Shah from Batch 22. Yashvi?
Hi. So, can you hear me?
Yes, you're audible.
So you've already touched upon my question a little bit. So when you were writing Sir, you talked about the history of representation, especially in Hindi cinema, with regard to the household as either sexualized characters or only invisible side characters. So how would you place Sir in the context of history of Hindi cinema as a whole, with respect to the characters?
Oh, I don't know. I can't answer that, honestly. Like, I don't know how to place my own film somewhere. Like, I can see Professor Chakravarti having a good laugh. You can answer the question. I really don't know. I mean, it's just a film. It's just a story. And I was just trying to be honest to these people. Like, I don't know what to say.
Okay.
So a couple of... Sorry, yeah. Go ahead, Yashvi, go ahead.
So how do you come up with this idea? Where did the inspiration strike or whatever?
So this is something that I sort of lived with my whole life, right? This question of how we live in our homes. I grew up with Live and Help. You know, I was really, really close to the woman who helped my mom raise me. And then even as a grown-up, right, even when I had my own apartment and I had people working, I was really aware of this kind of disparity. And it's something I struggled with. You know, even when I went away to college, right, I was studying in the US and coming back, and I would think, like, I'm secretly a wicked person, you know, like, I'm running around pretending that I'm cool and I believe in equality, but really the way I live, I'm just like everybody else. And there is this deep inequality and injustice, and I'm part of the system. And it's not that easy to break out of it. What do I do, right? I come home, I'm staying at my parents, or even when I'm in my own apartment, you can say, oh, I'll pay her decently, I'll educate her kid, all these things. But fundamentally, you know, it's like, you're not going to invite your household to sit at the table and eat with you, right? Because it's not done. So I think this is something, this question is something I struggled with basically my whole life. And I didn't know what to do about it because I don't have the answer, first of all. And I don't want to preach at anybody or tell anybody how to live, because I don't know what the answers are. But it was a question for me. And, you know, through life and, you know, thinking about questions and, you know, how we, even when I made my documentary, What's Love Got to Do with It, you know, thinking about these questions of how do we allow ourselves to love who we love, right? There's a moment that you allow it to happen, or you're aware, and either you stop it or you don't. Thinking about these questions, it occurred to me that I could talk about this issue that had been in my heart for so long through a love story, you know, and kind of broach the subject and then see what happens, you know, and then really try to, because that, you know, a love story allowed me to make them more equal in a certain way, you know, because right. When you fall in love with somebody, if she doesn't love you back, it doesn't really matter what's in your bank account, right? It's a kind of an equalizer. Like if you're talking about love, I'm not talking about exploitation or, you know, somebody taking advantage in any way. It's really, if it's a true love story, then both people become equal, you know? And then the other thing is that when you fall in love with somebody, it's very effortless to see their point of view, you know? You automatically you start to see things through their eyes. You start to think about their issues, their problems. And so even for us,
very beautiful. That's a very nice thought.
You know, so it's, you see the world differently, you know? And for me, I was like, okay, that's what we need, right? We need to see each other's points of view. And it's not about being preachy or trying to say this is the oppressor. And this, like, if you just see the other person's point of view, that's the first step towards change, you know? But it was just, for me, it was just a way to approach the subject without being preachy and boring, because that was my biggest fear.
Thank you.
Right. We should apologize for the excessive academic questions, but after like three semesters of history of cinema and like film theory and like hardcore subjects, we're pretty, yeah.
No, please don't apologize. I have to just tell you who I am, and I don't have all these answers, you know, so I can't really fake it. Yashvi, I really like your hair color, by the way.
The next question that we have is from Aditi Patel from Batch 22.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes.
Ma'am, I absolutely love the film. We all did, and we are really excited about your next project. So are there any films or scripts in the pipeline?
Yes. I'm writing. It's really hard. It's really hard to get back to writing, especially when you know, like I said earlier, you know that I've just realized through the process of making this film that I've been doing the hardest part, which is writing. And so it's hard. It's hard to get back to it. It's hard to, also second film is hard somehow because you're so judgmental, you know, and expectations are sort of high and people keep telling you, what are you going to do and do something good? And I don't know, maybe, you know, I don't know. So I'm writing and rewriting and that's where I'm at. Let's see.
Right. That was the last of our curated questions. However, we do have a question on chat. Ritvik, do you want to unmute yourself and ask the question? Or do you like me to do it?
Yeah, one second. Hello, sorry. Good morning and good afternoon. But anyway, I was very pleasantly surprised to find out that, like, you know, I looked your name up and I found out you were a writer on Jassi OSC in the early 2000s. And I was intrigued by that because it was interesting to know that your start was in an adaptation of a Colombian, already popular Colombian drama. So I wanted to know, what did you learn in your early years while adapting an international production for Indian audiences, like how Hannah was asking previously in terms of the different kind of gazes or views or lenses that people view TV shows in or movies in? What did you learn? And immediately after Jassi ended, I think Ugly Betty started in America, which was the adaptation, the American adaptation. So what changes did you see from your original work, from the original work to what you worked on to what happened later?
So first, I have to just tell you that I was one of the writers on Jassi Jaisi Kahani. Okay. So Victor was the main writer, Vijay Krishnacharya. He was mostly doing the story. So my job was really not so much adapting the original work. It was really like getting into the details of each screenplay and making each episode interesting, you know. So, and I think what I learned from that process, it doesn't really answer your question about international versus Indian, because I really didn't do that part of it. It was really about doing the work, and for me the learning in that was just craft. You know, television is really fun in a way because it's fast, you know. You write it, 2 weeks later it's on air. You have to be able to use your craft to create the commercial point, you know, the hook. So it's really about structuring and playing with things. It's not, you know, it's not huge, like deeply satisfying or whatever. You're not doing something very artistic, but it's really about the work, you know, the craft. And so then you have, which is really empowering later, because when you're writing a film later or when you're doing something, you know, I've worked as a script doctor with writers, and sometimes writers get scared when you tell them that, okay, you need to change it, You know, people don't like to change it. They don't like to rewrite because they think it's done. But I think what it gives you working in TV or working as a commissioned writer, what you learn is it's your radio. You can take it apart and put it back together, and you know, and you're confident about the nuts and bolts, you know. And I think that's really important learning, just doing the job, you know, just learning that you can, you know, doing commissioned work like that, that's what it accomplishes. But I don't have answers to the rest of it because I didn't do that.
Thank you.
Hi, I have a question. Hannah, can I ask?
Sure, sir.
This is connected to gender. Do you feel that you are paid as much as another filmmaker of your same level who might be a male? In terms of gender, we don't want to know the exact details, but how much percentage less you are paid compared to another comparable male actor, male director, if at all it happened?
I don't really know, but I think in this situation, I would take responsibility somewhere also for being, I think one has to learn to demand certain things, you know, and for me, it's been a challenge because I love what I do. And I've been so grateful to get, you know, when you get to do the work, that sometimes it's difficult to risk losing the job because you're negotiating, you know. I've had those kinds of things where I've been just so happy to work that I will do the work and not necessarily be very aggressive when it comes to payments and things, which I think it's also learning for me personally. But I think the challenge really is not so much about the how much you get paid, you know, but when you're pitching a film or when you're trying to get something made, which has been more of my journey in the past 2 years, the challenge is if you're pitching to a man who doesn't understand what you're trying to say, your film doesn't get made, you know. Like I've had that happen many years ago, you know, pitching to somebody, and I just got through the first sentence. I said she da 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 da, da. And he said what, you know, and he took a second back, and he said, oh, it's about this woman, and he instantly lost interest because first of all, it wasn't a storyline that he could connect to. Even with Sir, it you know, there's a way in which when it's a male producer, you need a person to be aware that he is not the only person in the world can judge for the world. Like if I'm a woman, let's say I was commissioning all the films in the world, right? Maybe Star Wars would never have gotten made because I wouldn't get it. You know, I wouldn't understand an action film or a Marvel film. I would be like, what is this thing? No, let's not make this, right? Because me, with my gender, with my background, with my interests, it would not interest me, but I would be so wrong. You know, I think the same thing happens in the reverse way with when women pitch to men sometimes, is that sometimes they don't get it. They don't get what you're talking about or why this film needs to get made. And of course, there are men who would get it. I don't want to generalize, but I think that's the challenge really as a woman sometimes. And so what I would really hope for is for more women in positions of power in media, you know, in distribution, in production, in all these areas, the decision makers, because even with Sir, right? After the film went to Cannes, after the film is like done so well in France, it's done well around the world, pitching it in India, every distributor I went to said, Tirotama, show him on the poster, how will we sell this film? You know?
Okay.
How will I can't do this. So Netflix included, you know, what will we do with this? What will happen? This, that, you know, very dhila response because you're not part of the star system. And because they didn't believe in it, you know. Eventually, I did an independent theatrical release, got all the reviews. There was so much buzz around the film. Netflix eventually took the film. They didn't promote it because they didn't think it would have any legs, you know. They didn't think it would survive. And it's the audience that drove it, you know.
So it was number one for a long time.
It was number one for a few days, and then it was in the top 10 for ages. But it was not thanks to, you know, if you have a Netflix original and they push it, so eventually you watch it. This had zero promotion. They didn't even mention it. Netflix didn't even mention the film the week that it released on their social media, nothing, nowhere. It's just the audience that drove it. But if I had been dependent on a distributor, you know, an Indian distributor to support the film and get a release and create the buzz, the film would have gone nowhere, you know? So I think for me, it's not so much about the inequality is not so much in terms of payments, it's in terms of the understanding of the other person and struggling with this sort of very male-dominated star system that we have, you know? Stars can also be star producers or star directors, you know, that your film should come under the banner of XYZ known producer, at least, so for us to take it seriously, you know? So I think it's those, I found that more challenging personally. Payments, it's really about negotiating better, which is something I need to learn to do.
Okay.
Right. That being the last question, I'd like to thank you for taking the time to interact with all of us and tell us about your experiences in the independent filmmaking arena. And more so to the fact of also talking about class and also talking about inspiration of character and how to look at things from a broader perspective and how, you know, the mechanics of things and the visual metaphors. And I'd like to thank you for that.
Thank you.
Now going a vote of thanks being presented by Ms. Sumalika.
Just say a few things before the. Hannah, sure. Just take a few minutes.
Sure, sure. Yes, sir.
Hello?
Your video is frozen, sir. For a second.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes. Go ahead.
I'm Ms. Rohina. I just wanted to share that, you know, we as a college, we have a specialization in film, film specialization, which is around 42 odd students. But of course, for this particular talk, all the batches, everybody has come. So I just want to share that all our film specialization students are, they undergo 2-3 internships. They work in studios like Yash Raj and many of the Bombay production. In fact, many of the mainstream Bollywood films, you find a lot of production work and all done by our students because they go on internships. So for your next film that you're planning, please tell us and we will send the entire production team from 6 days. They handle everything, 6 months of experience in lighting, editing, shooting, production, you know, costumes, set design. You know, they are familiar with a lot of things. So next film that you're planning, please think of our students as production assistants and whatever production help you want. I just want to share that.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that. Thank you, Anna, for your words as well. And thank you, Dr. Gopal Krishnan. Definitely. I have to first finalize my script. So I have to first get through that. But yeah, once I get into production, it would be really helpful actually, because especially if it's an independent film or even if it's not, I think it's great to have, you know, young people with good energy, you know, who are motivated.
And you will have the best production team in India, I can assure you, because our students are the best.
Thank you. Okay, I'll check with you later who to coordinate with when that happens.
Sure. Yeah. Sure.
Right. So Malika, would you like to continue?
Yeah. Thank you, sir, for motivating us. But good afternoon. I'm Sumalika Chabra from Batch 22. On behalf of the students of SCMC, I would like to take this opportunity to thank Ms. Rohina Gera ma'am for taking time off her schedule and presiding here to inspire us through her journey of independent filmmaking. It's been a wonderful experience hearing Ms. Gera talk about the nuts and bolts of a critically acclaimed film, sir. It was an altogether surreal experience to know about a film that you like so much and to actually get the chance to talk about it with the filmmaker. her persuasive words about the virtue of time and the art of learning through setbacks are going to remain with us lifelong. I will not be wrong to say this on behalf of the entire student body that we have gained so much insight in our own future today, and we are immensely grateful for it. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank Dr. Vidya Yeravtikar, ma'am, Pro-Chancellor of Symbiosis International University, for giving us her valuable time today. And thank you so much for your kind words, ma'am. On behalf of the student body, I would like to extend my appreciation for a platform like SCMC Perspectives that allows us to interact with professionals from the industry. A big thank you to the IT team for making today's event possible and ensuring its smooth flow. And lastly, I would like to thank all of you for being here today. Thank you. Have a nice day.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much for having me. It's been really fun to talk to all of you.
Thank you.